I started the company, Eugene Garfield Associates. Our letterhead was information engineers. Okay. And so I've always thought of myself as an engineer, and probably one of the reasons, motivations for wanting to change, get ACES to add the word technology to its title, because I didn't think of myself as an information scientist per se. Anyhow, it was, I think, about a year or so after, I don't know the exact date, I don't know if I even have a correspondence, it might be in my file somewhere. I got a letter from some state organization or some professional society of engineers saying, "Mr. Garfield, you cannot call yourself an information engineer, because if you are an engineer, you have to be licensed by the state of Pennsylvania. You have to be a licensed engineer. And in order to do that, you have to have, I guess, graduated from an accredited engineering school or done some other equivalent. I don't know what the rules are. And I don't even know if that's still true or not." I thought it was very funny, because it was only a few years later that it was either Saul Gorin or Morris Rubinoff at the University of Pennsylvania asked me to come over to teach graduate students a course in information retrieval. So anyhow, that was why I had to remove that designation from our letterhead. And by the time 1960 rolled around, we changed the name from Eugene Garfield Associates to Institute for Scientific Information, which had an entirely different kind of history. I didn't know until quite recently, actually, that and I think I read this in either some document that about the history of the field of information science, or either in Andrew Brown's book about John D. Bernal, that Watson Davis had actually used the term Scientists Institute for Information as a proposed entity that should be developed. And Watson Davis was a name well known to us, because he was one of the original founders of ADI, the American Documentation Institute, which started around 1935. And when I was still at Welch Library in Baltimore, ADI was still called ADI, and you could not be a member of ADI. You had only institutions or societies could be members of ADI. And it was more of a cooperative, almost like a nonprofit trade group of academic institutions that were trying to develop new technologies for their use. And so Watson Davis and other people like that were interested in things like microfilm and whatever, you know. So I thought it was very amusing that they would almost have anticipated that name. And at the same time, as I've often acknowledged, J.D. Bernal was not only an inspiration to me because of what he proposed in Social Function of Science. And when I looked at that book recently, I realized how much I'd forgotten about it over the years. I mean, it covers an amazing amount of material for a book that was written so far ahead of its time. He proposed, today people should know that he is probably the original, he would be supporting Steve Hornet and the open access movement. VTech Tracks and others would be interested in that too. But and the irony of all that is that the publishers, the society publishers, were just the same group that opposed Bernal's ideas then as are now opposed to the open access thing. It's kind of, nothing changes after how many years now? Let's see, about originally 39 he proposed it. That's about 75 years, nothing much has changed. So But the origins of information engineering back again, ADI started as an institutional thing. And then in 1952, they decided to make it a professional society and open it up to individuals. And that was when I first became a member. That's how I got to be, I think, probably one of the first members as an individual to join. I don't know the exact year, I think it was 52. And I had already been, I had met Jesse Shearer, who was the editor of American Documentation, which is the predecessor of the Journal of ACIST, you know? And he asked me, would I like to be an associate editor of the journal? I couldn't believe he would ask me. I thought it was supposed to be such an honorific thing, you know? And that was how I happened to be in a position to eventually invite W.C. Adair, the former vice president of Shepherd Citations, to write an article about citation indexes for science. Because what happened was, well, now we're jumping back and forth, I don't know how you're going to handle all this, but I had not only been interested in joining ADI, but prior to that, I had been involved in the information side of things simply because I learned about chemical information systems through, by accident, through James Perry. When I worked in the laboratory of Louis P. Hammett as a lab assistant at Columbia University, he was the editor of the McGraw-Hill series. And I guess, just like I was attracted to the public library, I was attracted to his personal library. He had a huge collection, the entire chemical abstracts, his own personal collection, and as the editor of the McGraw-Hill book series, he had access to a lot of material. And at the same time, I also found indexes that had been created in, I created indexes to all the chemical compounds that are in the closets at Columbia University, probably 100 years of students who had created compounds and labeled them, and all they needed was purification, and he could use them. And these guys were spending all kinds of time remaking this stuff. So I said, why should you do it all over again when we can do it, have it done before? So that's how I sort of got interested in chemical information systems and searching and so on, and I was just drawn to it.